So it's 2:30, and I think we should start. We've got a lot in the agenda, so... Welcome to this workshop. I'm very much looking forward to it. I hope you also do. Where we'll be talking about digital innovation hubs and how they can serve the digitization of Europe further, and especially the SMEs. We would like to introduce you a little bit more on the concepts of digital innovation hubs, and to help you further improve your ideas about it and make that more operational for your situation. But not only would we like to just give you a thought about what they are, we also want to give you some more practical information on how to initiate them and how to further evolve them. For us, it's important that you go home with this idea and be inspired by what we all say. And it means that we not only want to give you presentations, but we also would like to ask you to be as interactive as possible. So that interaction, there's also a Twitter account, and you can see those Twitter hashtags over there. Please, because there's another workshop going on about digitization in another location in Brussels. If you want to tweet, and we ask you to tweet, because those questions will be collected, please include both hashtags into it. So the day is divided in two sessions. The first session is about building up a digital innovation hubs from the more bottom-up side in regions, which is focusing more on what they are and what the nitty-gritty details in operationalizing it, what does that mean. And the second panel will be much more focused on the national level and what can governments do and what is required from the governments that can be regional, national, and European, how to help them to get it in place, why should national governments put a lot of attention to it. So that's the introduction to the workshop. And I would like to ask the first presenter up to the stage. Khalil, could you come to the stage? Khalil is the director of the Directorate A, Components and Systems of DG Connect. He has some experience in that nitty-gritty engineering because he was also a director of Grand Ecole, and he's an engineer by background. He will introduce us a little bit more to the concept of digital innovation hubs, especially, of course, from the perspective of the European Commission. Khalil.
Thank you, Maurits. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to have you all here. I hope we will spend a very nice and lovely afternoon together on digital innovation and on digital innovation hubs. So let me start by contradicting a bit Maurits, saying that the directorate has changed. That I'm director for is called Digital Industry now, since beginning of July. So it's normal. He doesn't know. This is what I'll be telling you about is our strategy for digitization of European industry, and how digital innovation hubs fit within this strategy. But let me just see before, how familiar are you with our policy in this field? So who is in the room familiar, has read, has knowledge about our strategy for digitizing European industry that was issued on the 19th of April? Excellent. Probably I should then stop. Most of you are familiar with it. Also, there's still some who don't know about it, but don't worry, we'll introduce you to that. So that's good. We'll try to go further than what we presented, of course, on the 19th of April. Now, since 6 months, we have progressed. We, when I say we, means member states, us, the industrial community, has moved on accelerating the digital transformation or helping industry accelerate its digital transformation in Europe. And so we'll brief you about latest developments. And today we will talk mainly about implementation of these actions that we proposed and how they can be done with industry, member states, commission, EU level intervention. So, I hope that I get there. Do I get the right thing, Eve? Is it? It's good.
Just click on the name, please.
Okay, that's it. That's better. Now I recognize myself, so I'm here. Digitization of European industry, that strategy issued on the 19th of April. One overall objective described by my commissioner as ensuring that any industry in Europe, big or small, wherever situated in any sector, can fully benefit from digital innovations to upgrade its products, improve its processes, and adapt its business model to the digital change. Every word counts. And we talk about fully benefit from digital innovation, so it's not about digital technologies only. So it's not about taking technology that exists and putting it in your processes. It's also about being engaged with innovating in digital as well. The added value is maximized for any business if it can get access to latest technology, if it can also contribute to the development of digital technologies. Today, industries need to be co-innovating in any sector with digital experts, with digital knowledge experts, in order to be able to be at the leading edge, compete at a global scale. Or some call it reintegration of digital innovations within your value chain. Some call it tough or intensive digital innovation in your value chain. But it's the issue about making sure that you do not miss the opportunity of capturing value from digital innovation and its progress. Well, we propose a comprehensive policy initiative combining policy instruments, financing, legislation, coordination, and working, steering bottom-up innovation as well as support-focused actions. And we will be talking about this today, mostly the bottom-up innovation, as you'll see. What was this proposal about? We had five blocks of actions that we proposed in April. The first one is the one we'll be talking about. It's mainstreaming digital innovations across all industrial sectors. Let's see what it means. Second one was more strengthening competitiveness in the key parts of the digital value chain. If you want, the first one is more about bottom-up innovation. The second block of action is more about mission-driven policy actions, man on the moon type of actions that you'll see under strengthening competitiveness to make sure that Europe is present, industry in Europe is present in key parts of the digital value chains. And it's not only about the IT industry or the telecom industry strength, it's the digital value chains that are important for all industrial sectors, from automotive to machinery to construction to textile, etc. That's the digital value chains and strengthening competitiveness in these areas. It's mainly about technologies and mainly about platforms, the key next generation platforms on which value is created. How can we make sure that we have our contribution to the development of these platforms worldwide? With that package, with that block, we said there are two also very specific actions that we need to launch on the 19th of April. When we talk about key technology, we talk about key platforms, the key issue that comes in is standardization, and we have also issued a communication or strategy for standardization related to digitization of European industry. We prioritize standards, and we said how these standards could be developed. We also took the example of an area where we should be present in the future, where today we're losing track, where we're losing in terms of competitiveness. This is the area of cloud in general and computing and next generation high performance computing. There as well, we should a strategy that should bring us back into the league of the leaders in this area. At the same time, also, we explain what are the opportunities with the soft working documents that are emerging from the Internet of Things, an important area for digital transformation of industry. A third block of actions that came is a block action on regulation, data flow, ownership and use. One of the issues that the industry mentioned as extremely important to address from the regulatory perspective, and in November we'll be putting on the table a package on the data economy and what needs to be done on regulation in this area. We're also working on trust, security, liability from the regulatory aspects, and there are actions that are announced in this field. And the fourth block, extremely important as well, is preparing our workforce, adapting to the new working methods, and that's training, skills, and rethinking the work environment. And the fifth block of action is an action that member states, industry told us that we should all together put in place is a coordination framework where different national initiatives, different regional initiatives can exchange ideas, and where we, with member states, with regional authorities, with national initiatives, can define what needs to be done by private sector, by the public sector, at EU level, national level, etc. This is the package as proposed. We're focusing today on that part, the mainstreaming of digital innovations across all sectors. So why are we proposing this? Very clear. Message that came from industry telling us what needs to be done to accompany the digital transformation. It's an industrial issue. Industrial transformation is for industry. What can public sector do? Problem we're facing is return investments when it comes to digital innovation is difficult to assess upfront, mainly for non-tech industries, SMEs. Problems in trusting the technology, security, safety have problem in addressing the maturity of the technology, are not clear about compatibility, interoperability with legacy systems, are afraid but not locked in with one vendor. The percentage is more than two-thirds when it comes to SMEs, but of course, I mean, high-tech companies are already engaged in this, so the knowledge is much wider. Clear need to test, experiment before engaging in digital innovation. This is the conclusion came out from this analysis, and this is what we, together with the member states or with regional authorities, et cetera, try to help industry do, i.e. Experiment, test. One goal that we try to achieve with this part is make latest digital technologies available for an industry wherever it is, for all industry, wherever situated in Europe. This is about testing, experimenting with innovation and product processes, new business models. It's really bottom up. Make the technology available for the users to make sure that they can use it, test, experiment with it, and see what they can do. One concept that we put on the table for this, what we call the networks of digital innovation hubs, which is about presence of competence centers at a working distance from any industry, wherever situated in Europe, so a competence center that could provide these facilities, provide access to these facilities, provide access to knowledge, provide access to technology, and make sure that that center is connected to other centers in Europe so that they can offer one-stop shop. No one center can be excellent in all areas. And it's not about access to, you know, to technology that is on the market, it's access to latest innovation to give you the competitive advantage, to give industry that competitive advantage that is needed. This is what we're looking for. Targeting SMEs, startups, non-tech industry, stimulating a wave of bottom-up digital innovations across regions, across Europe. We build on our successes in this area. 5 minutes. We build on our successes in the area, or we build on successful experiences in the area. So we did not invent this from scratch. It comes from experiences that we've seen in the member states. Here are some examples of what has been done in the member states. It comes from experiences that we have also in our actions that we started in 2014-15. I've put here some of these actions that you could see at European level, like I4MS. We'll talk about it a lot today, about smart anything everywhere. I4MS about manufacturing. Smart anything everywhere is about connected objects. ECHOD about robotics and AI. Act Fast about photonics. Fireware, it's built about around the platform of Fireware. There as well, we're stimulating innovation around this core platform was developed, called IHubs. There is also the IT, which has competence centers spread across Europe and connected, and there are bottom-up EU or EU-wide actions like Vanguard. So if I take one example, the I4MS, show you a bit what we do in I4MS, for those of you not familiar with this. This is an action started in 2014. What I'll show here very quickly in 4 minutes is what we can bring at EU level, an example of what we can bring at EU level. But you will be hearing more and more during the afternoon what the member states are doing at regional level, examples, and what also SMEs are benefiting and industries benefiting from this. Well, this is what we can put on the table. Examples: I4MS, 110 million euro of EU funding of 11 networks of competence centers across Europe, 70 competence centers, grouped into 11 networks. So far, in 2 years of 110 million euros of funding, we've been able to support 280 experiments. Remember, testing, experimenting by SMEs, mainly here. SMEs testing new technology and see how they can benefit from it. 480 contractors, 340 industrial, 75% of SMEs and mid-caps, half of them are users, 65% new to the research. That's very interesting because that gives us the possibility to connect new actors in this field. 28 member states engaged, plus associate countries. You've seen the map there. Now, it's not all member state coverage with the same intensity. Our ambition is, of course, with the help of the member states, the regions, to increase that map all over Europe, or to widen that map across Europe. Example of one of the networks. This is a network in Fortissimo. It's about using advanced simulation, visualization, and data analytics by industry, and providing expertise for any industry to test these new technologies, latest technologies in this field. We have 16 innovation hubs, so 16 competence centers and their ecosystem that are engaged in Fortissimo. 94 experiments so far, so close to 100 experiments done in Fortissimo. We spent 26 million euros to support 100 SMEs. Keep these figures, they're important. This is one of the things we do. This is an SME in Sweden that do design for race cars. No, very, very advanced design. SME cannot have access to HPC, you would understand. They cannot buy it. So what they do through in Fortissimo is connect with centers that are in Italy using tools that come from the UK. This is the connection that we have across Europe. And you could see the results there, what it brought to the SME. This is in the design of cars. It's not only about design of cars and high tech. It's also about shoemaking. It's about all types of industry. This is another example of professional shoemakers from Italy connecting. It's an SME connecting with an SME in Spain and using a competence center on high performance computing in Spain. This is what we can offer. Another example on green energy, same. Look at the constituency down there and what they can do. Another example in robotics, that was about high performance computing, access to simulation, for data analytics, etc. And you could see the change that this gives not only to the product, but also to the business model, like, you know, 3D printing of shoes for professional shoes that you could see in this one. Product, process, and business model. This is about robotics, and there as well. I mean, the example, this is very simple, a tire workshop. I took these examples on purpose to tell you that this can happen in any industry in Europe, this huge innovation. This is really about tire workshop, robotic assistant, and you could see there which companies are coming from where and what they're doing. The same thing, access to latest robotics technology to develop innovative product embedded in processes. That's another example. Harvesting, green asparagus harvesting, precision farming, very important as well. And you could see who works with whom across Europe to get latest robot technology into the field, into agriculture. Another example, I moved from green asparagus on purpose to high tech for medicine. And this is a company that does medical equipment. And you could see robotics technology for surgery with wide range of application. This is also an application that we're testing. And look at the amounts that we put there. They're not big amounts. The return investment, action by action, looks small. You know, we're talking about millions of euros of return on investment of 250,000. But if you group them all together, altogether, you get returns on investments on 100 million that are in the billions of euros. And this is just to start. This is what we're trying to do so far. We will be able to support 100 SMEs, 200 SMEs, 300 SMEs at EU level, but the scope of the possibilities is huge, from precise farming to shoemaking to medical surgery. Huge, enormous opportunities across all sectors. Now, if we pool our action together, member states, regions, to reinforce these competence centers, this is what they're telling us. We're not able to respond to the demand. It's so huge, from connected objects to robotics to data analytics to simulation, etc. Huge demand. They're connecting themselves, so that networking is bringing value. You could see it. But we need big investments to be done in reinforcing these competence centers. We'll be putting 500 million euro on these activities ourselves to build that networking and stimulate the collaboration across borders. But we think that member state, using the facilities they have, using structural funds, using possibilities from the EIB, like FC, they could put 10 times more, and we could build that network of innovation hubs that could serve all our industry. Thank you very much.
This one should work. So I would like to ask our next keynote speaker, Victor Negrescu, to come up to the floor. By the way, could I ask you all to turn off your the sound of your telephone, because that might be a little bit disturbing. Victor is EU Parliament for Romania, EU Parliamentary...
European Parliament.
Thank you. For Romania, he has his...
For Europe, not for Romania.
Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah. Okay. representing Romania, is that right? Correct? He is, has his education in political science, and but what is very important now is that he has been engaged in to launch a larger program to support the new member states with the development of these digital innovation hubs. So, Victor, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here to meet you all and participate at the Digital Assembly. It seems that we don't have enough places. I saw people coming and getting out, so this is good. And I'm glad to be here because besides being a member of the European Parliament and being very active on digital issues, I used to be a digital entrepreneur. I helped create in my home country, Romania, more than 1,000 jobs. By doing so, I understood the need to do things at European level, because there are some things stopping us in using our potential. And it's about potential that I want to talk to you about today, about the fact that we have the knowledge, we have the skills, we have the industry, we have a lot of things to do, but unfortunately, we don't have the tools that are capable of making us work together even better. And I really believe that the digital innovation hubs are an excellent tool to do so. Because how I see things today in Europe? So in Europe, we have the industry. Industry looks like this, it's nice, very interesting, made in China, like Europe. And we have another name, yeah. And we have the charger. Charger is a little bit like the environment in Europe, the ecosystem. So it brings energy, it has highly skilled human resources, a good consumption market. This is Europe. Both together, unfortunately, do not work. No? They need each other, but they do not work together. And we have the European ecosystem. The European ecosystem today looks like this. It's a mess. It's complicated, no? And we have to use those three products together. And what we should do is kind of easy, you know? We have to try to merge them. So how do we do that? It's very easy. You know, it looks easy from outside. And we start plugging the three things together. They still look messy. It's complicated. We have a way from getting to, from the charger to the phone, but it's still very complicated. In order to make things work, we need to, can you help me?
Yes.
Pull things and make them look like this. So a straight line, very concrete, very simple, to get from the charger, Europe, and the potential of our industry. And how we can do that? It's through the digital innovation hubs. I really believe we can do that, because such hubs together with the competence centers, enable us to fight against the things that block us and block the potential of the European digital market. Because, for instance, I think we are facing, first of all, a lot of mistrust. We are worried about everything in Europe. We are scared to fail. We are scared about to work with the big players because they are going to steal our ideas. We are scared of losing control over our businesses. We are scared that technology will destroy the industry. We are scared that automatization will bring unemployment. We are so scared that we forget to do things. And in my opinion, at European level, we can find those solutions to fight against the things that scare us. For instance, we can think about a plan where we can introduce simple things. I like to call it the number one plan. One European law, one taxation model, one digital ID, one stop shop, like the Digital Innovation Hub, one center for the development of IT skills, one plug and connectivity mechanism, one clear financing mechanisms, one solution, one idea. And I really believe we can do all of that, because this will enable us to fight also not only with our worries, but also with our weaknesses, because our worries are making our weaknesses stronger than they actually are. For instance, our need at European level to develop the negotiation capacity of SMEs, our need to work in interdisciplinary projects, our need to enable our startups to scale up to medium-sized companies. This is a big problem across Europe. Our need to build synergies between different players. Sometimes, especially in Central and Eastern Europe, we have difficulties in working with each other because of our historical past and what used to be before. But we also need to do something very important. We need to involve our citizens, because the digitalization process, I really believe, is not a revolution. It is about evolution. It is about survival. And if we want to survive, we need everyone to participate. We need everyone to understand, and we need everyone to work together with us. Because by involving our citizens, we develop entrepreneurship skills. We make them become donors or financiers of companies, and we democratize their participation. And we show that digitalization and innovation bring good things to them. Because, like I said, we have worries, we have weaknesses, but we also have strengths. Our biggest strength is our diversity, but we have to know how to use it. The digital innovation hubs enable us to use our diversity at the beginning at national state level and afterwards at European level, and use the things that divide us in order to make us work together, produce more, produce wisely, produce more efficiently, and basically use the entire potential that we have here at European level. Because very often we speak about the need of creating a Silicon Valley in Europe. I don't want a valley in Europe. We have mountains, we have seas. We need some silicon to unite all of us, to enable us to work together. And this project is not all the silicon that we need, but it's something, a good first touch that will enable us to work together. And we really try to do that. And I met a lot of passionate people willing to do so. And the reason why I was invited here is that I'm the member of the European Parliament that initiated the biggest number of pilot projects in the European Parliament. What is that? Every member of the European Parliament can initiate annually projects that aren't usually financed by the Commission in different fields. I personally convinced my colleagues in the European Parliament and the Commission to finance, and I even got two today, to finance 8 projects in the digital sector, financed with a total of 9.3 million euros. And one is designed to enable the digital innovation hubs to reach the blanks on the map, because I don't know if you recall, there were some blanks, especially in Central and Eastern Europe, and hopefully, together with the Commission, we will manage to do so. But like I said, I really believe, and this is why I wanted to participate at this assembly, I really would like to see this assembly bringing a change at European level, maybe not a revolution, but at least an evolution. And hopefully we can all work together in doing so. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Victor. I think you've got a very inspiring thought about cooperation, and Khalil did mention and that made clear that digitization is a very important element, and there's a lot of opportunities here to bring digitalization through innovation hubs further to our European industry. So very, very good. Now we're entering in the first panel discussion, which will focus on the more nitty-gritty things of those digital innovation apps, just to help you get a bit better grip on those animals, so to say. I would like to ask our first panelist to come on board. Mr. Garcia, please, can you join us? Mrs. Schoenig, Mr. Perisic, and Hans Praat, could you join us for the discussion? And I'm forgetting someone. Germina Raku. It's horrible for me to those names, because if I... the Raciokatis, perhaps he can introduce himself better later on.
Yes.
Yes. So what we will be doing now is allowing the panelists to just come up with a kind of a statement based on one slide about what they think is important with digital innovation hubs, what their main message is. And I would like to ask Rafael Casilla first. He is a chemical engineer by training, as I am. For me, it's about 30 years ago, and it's very hard for me even to tell my daughter how to do her chemistry lessons. But I'm sure it's for you, it's much much easier to do that. He is the deputy director of the Research Community of Madrid, and what is very important here is that he can share with us his experiences with setting up the Robo City 2030 project, and which can be considered as a digital innovation hub. Rafael, could you use that? Yes.
Great. Thank you. So thank you, Maurits, and yes, for the kind introduction. Good afternoon, everybody. So I want to focus my small intervention on the innovative hubs of Madrid region. This is a completely pioneering initiative. I mean, it was created by the Madrid government 7 years ago. This initiative of the Madrid government is the crucial stakeholders for this initiative, because it's the responsible of detecting some different needs for innovation in the different companies and enterprises, mainly SMEs companies, startups, spin-off companies, etc. So this initiative consists of detecting these needs, and once the needs are detected, the Madrid government finance and develop a kind of networking ecosystem of different R&D stakeholders. So universities, research organisms, different scientific park clusters, I mean, all the stakeholders, R&D stakeholders of the Madrid region. So the just for transferring, of course, the R&D initiative into valuable and innovative products. The interest for the companies, I mean, is to have a strong collaboration with these R&D organisms. I mean, just to develop and to increase the know-how, the competitiveness of these companies, the productivity of these companies, and also just for using, I mean, the different infrastructure that this organism possesses in the Madrid regions, just for increasing the new products of the companies, the processes, and also the prototypes. So that's more or less, I mean, the initiative in the Madrid region. So let me bring your attention just in one slide, please, just for showing an example of this kind of innovative hubs in the Madrid region. Yeah, you can see here, this is the Road City 2030. You can see here, all the stakeholders around. So there is in Madrid an interesting kind of nest of companies dedicated to the robotic, just for different, things, like, Khalil says, previously, rescue robot, healthcare robot, field robotics, a lot of different companies, involved in this kind of area. So the Madrid government is detecting these needs and is creating a networking skyfall, a networking, platform or ecosystem with different universities here and organizing research organisms. You can see here more than six different centers of research with different or more than 100 researchers involved in this project. This center, these R&D stakeholders, develop knowledge. This knowledge is transferred to the companies. You can see here there are 29 industrial partners just with this technology transfer participating in these innovative hubs and also different spin-off companies. And which is more important, the creation of new jobs, the creation of new spin-off companies, the creation of new startups companies. So it's quite important, this one, for solving, at the end, the social needs of the people. So, and of course, the government of Madrid, different cities in the region of Madrid, are completely involved in this kind of innovative hubs. Also, it's quite important to mention, as previously I think somebody told, so something about the extra funding, so just the return on investment that the Madrid region is receiving because of that. For every euro, so every 1 euro of financiation of the Madrid government, the Madrid region receives return more or less between 9 and 10 euros. Just proceeding of new jobs, proceeding of different calls, different competitive calls around D&I, national, international calls, different researchers calls, and of course, funding for different private companies. So it's, I think, quite important also just for developing this kind of innovative hubs.
1 minute.
Okay, sorry. So I think it's quite important just, to develop, this kind of consortium, to develop this kind of networking ecosystem, not only in Madrid region, so and in the whole Europe. I think, the European Union can boast this kind of action just for helping, to the companies to sell by e-commerce or in the cloud or, digitalizing, the different companies. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Rafael. Next speaker is Mrs. Gaby Schoenig. I think it's quite interesting because she has an education in law. And that brings another perspective, I think, to the floor. And I think that might be interesting to hear from you. She is at this moment deputy governor of the state of Carinthia in Austria. And she is already from 1999 in the Corinthian government, so that's quite some experience. I think what you also could do is a little bit connect the more industrial side to the human resources, employment, job side. So please, Gaby.
Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for the invitation. I think the quotes for the duration of my participation in the government is not quite right. I was for 9 years, then I did kind of a startup, and then I'm entered government again. So it's quite different experience. I would like to add a broader view on digital innovation. It's much more than industry. It's much more than having labs somewhere. It's about education, infrastructure, cooperation, and it's above all about the mindset we have to change. And thank you for the inspiring speeches at the start. I think that's the topic. We have to work together. We have to allow mistakes. Fail once, make it better the second time. And we start in Carinthia to work together with our neighbor regions, it's Styria, because Carinthia alone would be too small to be seen on an international level. We start very early with education, with educational labs where very small children are educated hands-on on natural sciences. So mathematics has not to be a boring thing. physics has not to be something you don't understand, because you can work hands-on and you have the experience and they are having fun. We educate the teachers so they have the knowledge how to make fun for the children and to raise them with a different spirit. That's one of the elements that are very important, because we won't change the mindset, we won't have interest in natural sciences if we don't start very early. The second is infrastructure. Right now we are having a program providing broadband in every area of Carinthia. For example, right now we have got a rural area, it's about 800 inhabitants, and it's fiber to the home. It's 100 Mbit upwards that every house gets there. And you don't know what is able to be created until you give the opportunity. And one topic I would like to mention, it's one project we have together with Styria. It's Silicon Alps Cluster. We are working together with 40 member companies. It's 10 universities and universities of applied sciences and research units. And it's about 29,000 employees working together on different fields. And it's really inspiring to see them working together, creating new things. And some of the lessons we have learned is you have to trust each other. You can't stipulate, and I'm a lawyer, everything in a contract. It's trust you have to make. You can't regulate everything. Systems are organizing themselves. So you have to trust also in this ability of companies, of universities, of governments. And it's really inspiring to work together. And the second thing, you have to be passionate about what you do. You have to believe in the goal you're stating together to make with digital innovation more than developing one part of industry. And just one more example, we are also developing the supply chain to make craftsmen feel that they are a part, a very important part of digital innovation. It's a difference whether you paint a kitchen or a clean room. And you have to enable the painter to do both. And that's what we are doing now, a program where craftsmen take part and we enable them to meet or to supply the innovation you need to take part in digital innovation. And people are eager to participate, to be part in this. And the anxiety at the beginning, am I able to take part, and all the trust you have to in working together, they come very soon. So my advice is not too much regulation, try things. It takes some effort, it takes trust, and it takes one thing I would like to also give us an idea. We have to have our data safe in Europe. That's one big project that has to be fulfilled, because that would make it much more easier. And the last thing I would like to add, it's the strategy you have to follow. Don't follow 5, 6, 7 different goals. State 1 or 2, follow them. Start and then get to the next one. And you also have, also as an official position, the right to make a decision that will not prove right at the end. Because not everything you venture is a success, but every success has been a venture once, and you should always think of this as one of the driving parts when you start digital innovation.
Thank you. Thank you. That's a very different perspective also on the Digital Innovation Hub, where you create the link to the more societal issues. So very good. There's also another perspective to be given, and Luigi Perisic can do that, I think, very easily. He's from industry. He is the... I'll say it in English because my Italian is not that good, the Director General of the Innovative and Technology Services Group. And he is representing some 150,000 companies, Luigi. So that's quite a bit, I would say. And please share us your insights on digital innovation hubs from the industrial point of view.
All right, thank you very much. Yes, we are a federation represent business services, to make it a little bit perhaps clearer. And we have been engaged into these issues from many years now, and working with the Commission to bring this to help bring this strategy to fruit. Because services and business services are fundamental in the transformation of manufacturing, and that's why we are here today. What we have done is building now a network of five hubs in Italy. We managed to help our regional entities to present a proposal, a project, into the last call of I4MS to create hubs. We have been successful with the five proposals. These hubs are located in the Piemonte region, Emilia-Romagna, Lazio, Marche, and Puglia. So five regions. Well, Lombardia is not there. Perhaps you know that Lombardia is very important, but they already had a hub, so they couldn't participate. So they're already part of the network. But regions that have very strong manufacturing industry presence, a lot of SMEs, industrial districts that you know was a typical setup of SMEs in Italy to work together, particularly in products of the Made in Italy, and strong ecosystems at regional level. The challenge for us, particularly for Italy, based on the industry base that we have that is mainly made by SMEs, is to make SMEs benefit from digitalization. It's easier, it's much easier, let's enough to look at what Germany is doing with the large companies to convince them that of the needs to invest into digitalization, to change their business models. That's I mean, it's easier. SMEs is a different ball game, and that's why we invested so much effort into convincing our regional entities to participate to this call, and also we work very much with DigiConnect into the development of the concept, because we really believe the digital innovation hubs are the key, are the connection between the technologies that are available, the innovation that is available, and let's say the head of entrepreneurs that has to be convinced they can make money with this. Because if you don't convince them that this is an opportunity to be more profitable, to be more competitive, they will not do it. They will consider this a fad, and they will not act. Clearly, policies can help. Now, on the 21st of September, our minister has presented the Italian strategy on manufacturing 4.0. We will see there will be incentive for companies, but that's not enough. We need to be at a company level in the territories where things happen and be able to provide a tailor-made answer to the question that entrepreneurs have. So in order to do that, being through what Khalil has said before, that all the value chains, all the value creation of a company are impacted by digitalization, there will be a lot of questions, very different ones. So the hubs must be able to provide this answer in cooperation with the competence centers, but also in cooperation with the network of hubs that are being created at European level. This, I think, is important, is a call that I make to the Commission to increase the value of this network. Make it enlarge, as they've done it before, to continue to make it larger with excellent partners, but increase the value of this network, providing, letting everybody provide their knowledge base to the network. And in this way, I think they will make this work of the hubs much easier. I have 1 minute, perhaps. Yes, the what I've chosen as a slide, I've been now very limited in that, is the example of why we have started with the regions, because member states are doing something more or less, but a bit slow. The regions with the S3 strategy that the Commission has has promoted, already have set up in the last couple of years tools to help digitalization innovation. So we felt that building on that, we can create hubs that can help companies to transform. An example is the one in Piemonte. For instance, in 2009, the Association of Industry in Piemonte created this innovation pole that is called MESAP, that is Meccatronica and Sistemi Avanzati di Produzione, that in 2016 has developed into smart products and manufacturing. So he has, starting from a technology core to a more all-round 4.0, let's say, industry digitalization goal. There are 11 research centers, 30 large enterprises, 195 SMEs that work together in order to accelerate digital innovation. I think this is the goal, is to build on what already exists, because I don't believe that there is any region in Europe that hasn't made effort in the last couple of years on innovation, but working with the industry, try to reorient, to focalize the efforts to accelerate the digitalization of SMEs. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very good to hear that industry also sees the need of cooperation and these digital innovation hubs, and also to get to the various individual SMEs, and that's a hard thing to do, but it's good to see that it's happening in Italy. Next speaker is Hans Praat. He is the coordinator of the Dutch Field Lab region of smart factories, one of the Dutch so-called field labs, but he is also representative of the Northern Development Agency in the Netherlands. And that's interesting because that regional development agency has a role in stimulating these kind of activities from a little bit of a different perspective. So being involved in setting up the field lab for quite some time already, Hans, I'm sure you can help us understand a little bit better the nitty-gritty details of setting up a digital innovation hub.
Okay, thank you. Do we have our slide? Thank you for the invitation. I was told that it should be about bottom-up initiatives, and I think we are a very good example for bottom-up initiatives, because I've never been in Brussels before, once in a Manufuture conference, and I even didn't know what digital innovation hubs were, to be sure. But we have one, huh? And even a very big one that fits perfectly in the definition of the digital innovation hubs. What we set up is a big field lab, what in the Netherlands, and Maurits is involved, what we call Industry 4.0, is called Smart Industry. We have a national innovation agenda. A main instrument is the field labs. We have now 10 field labs, and the region of smart factories is the biggest, the oldest, 25 million euro as a budget. This morning, and for me myself, I put it as the Bratislava target. I formulated that I want to organize 100 million for my program and everything that's follow-up. So what are we talking about if you say 2 million for such a big transition as we are about to do it? It's too big for 2 million euros. So you can follow me. I would like to have 100 million from own region for my consortium partners to make the transition to. I put some of the characteristics here on the slide, Northern Netherlands. It's all about artificial intelligence in manufacturing. The ambition for the manufacturing industry is always smart products in smart factories. So smart products to get market share and smart factories to make jobs out of it. And that's the future strategy of the manufacturing industry. I don't know if the concept of smart factory is known to you, but in a very short definition, it's a factory environment where you can produce single products for the cost of mass manufacturing. What you should do to organize this is very different from current industries. So the step is extremely big. And smart means intelligent, connected, and customized, as well as for the product side, for the process side. All the investments you're doing is in this field. We have a special focus, high mix, high volume, 40 partners. It's very, very rapidly expanding, a big project. We are working on the ecostructure. We have our own chair, we have our own professors, we have a competence center with the higher education institutes. So we are altogether organizing not so much a project, but a large community of companies cooperating together, because the step from traditional to digitalized manufacturing is too big to do on your own. That's as an introduction. Is it clear?
Thank you, Hans. I think it is a quite interesting example of a digital innovation hub, although it might be a little bit stronger, including also some other aspects. I will be expecting a lot of questions from the audience to Hans in order to find out what those nitty-gritty important lessons learned are. Let me now introduce you the last speaker for the panel, and then I can come down to the floor and give you the microphone. Gediminas Ratsiukatis is the head of the Department of Laser Technologies of the Center of the Physical Science and Technology in Lithuania. Lithuania, isn't it? So he's got a perspective of a new member state. And the new member state perspective is a little bit different from the perspective of what you're going to hear later on from the MTC, UK, Germany, the Netherlands, France, etc., etc. So, Gediminas, please.
Thank you. Really, we are now sitting in the panel bottom up. So we could go start from the very ground. And good introduction from Europe Commission, for Parliament, for big countries, strong industries, and what to do for us. We are still named as new countries, less developed countries, how to start it. In all this, it's very difficult to find really brilliant idea where we can start. And here I try to show you our examples. Even when I go to Brussels, quite often ask, why Lithuania is so famous with the lasers? Simply, history. We have a long history relation with research and industry. This industry was developed by research, and now it influenced back our activities in research. I also working with industry back to research, and all this work together. So, and all the competence we have is pushed by our industry. This industry is a supplier. They supply good tools for technologies, for production, but we have no end users in the country, because all this industry is collapsed, and so we're working, so we should have very broad view on application. We can apply these technologies, we can develop using our industry tools, but when we are missing end users, it's very difficult to specialize if you go to very deeply inside. Please press. Ah. Yeah, and for us it's very good example was that private and public partnership program, I4MAS, and we succeed to get Apollo project. One of those many projects that are running on this initiative. Now we have 36 partners, and only 5 of them are research entities. So we established Apollo hubs, so it's competence centers around the Europe that can help small companies that develop nice tools to validate, to assess them for real industrial applications. So we found that those small companies, not only in our country, but in other countries, have now direct access to huge system integrators and users to show that their equipment is really what they need. And This is very good example for us how to assess end users that we have now in our country. And another way, also with this network inside the Apollo, we gain additional competences. We're missing in every those competence centers. Really what the commission asked to have networking, we have this. And this networking within Apollo, it makes it for us a lot of visibility. Now we are very visible, even though we are from small country, maybe unknown research center with quite short history, only 6 years. But also this project helped us to make a trust that we can do good things for all European companies, and we see that how many companies coming to us. Yeah. And where we are now. If we look locally on our center, it's the largest research institute in Lithuania. 700 people working with half of them researchers. But we have also technopark, scientific park in our campus. It really helps to make some additional job. And working with the local industry, this technopark, establish some cluster and attracts not only laser and photonic companies, but also engineering companies. This helps us really make this what it's written about the digital innovation hubs, triangle. Maurits? Yeah. We have competences in our center. It's related more with laser technology, but we are looking at other applications also. We have technology transfer center, that's our park. And we have a cluster that includes our companies. They have some founding, some business plans, and this helps us to attract some money. Of course, for this, we need support. We need support to build this our environment. And especially, we would like to make end users community in our country. So for this, to addition to our competences, we need to make some like pilot lines running that can help people that have ideas to develop business that can use laser technologies and photonic technologies to make some environments. They can test those technologies, and it will be new business for this. Really, that's
what I like. Thank you. It's very good to have that perspective also from a new member state. And I'm sure you've got a lot of questions now, so I'll get down to the floor if I can. Well, I hope my knees will be okay now. Yeah, getting old, sorry about that. There will be a lot of questions, I'm sure, and I would like to, before we go to also the Twitter wall for a moment, I would like to give you the floor and please, who got a question for a panelist?
Yes. Good afternoon. This is. Yes, I'm István Rény from Hungary, working for the Hungarian government. I have a question, but not to the panelists, but to the speakers, namely to Khalil Rouhana. He was speaking about the digital innovation hubs. But in his presentation, he also named the EIT, the European Innovation and Institute and Technology Institute, which has quite a lot of very important programs and the so-called knowledge and innovation centers. My question is, what is the relationship in between the digital innovation hubs and the KISIs, the knowledge and innovation centers?
Thank you.
Khalil. Yeah.
Well, as you see, I mentioned all the experiences that we have, and we have here a lot of experiences also from the member states in building these what we call digital innovation hubs. Just to make sure that, you know, what we proposed as strategy is around scaling up these concepts, or scaling up these actions at EU level.
and we're not branding any particular action that this is an innovation hub, this is not. And the EIT as such, with the knowledge communities and the IT, I take the ICT labs, I mean the ICT, the IT, their network of competence centers is an example also of innovation hubs that we do. And the their competence centers do apply to initiatives that we launch at the EU level to support the development of innovation hubs like I4MS, et cetera. So that's the way we see it, to make sure. I think the worst thing we can do in this process, that's why we called it bottom up, the worst thing we can do is to start now putting strings around this and say this is a hub, this is not a hub, this is an initiative or not. I think it's about really organic development of these, I would say, innovation hubs and clusters all around Europe. That's the idea. That's the idea.
Does that answer your question? Other questions?
Okay, thank you very much for the information. This is Haluk Gökmen from Turkey. I would like to know, we have heard many experiences, and also Moritz, I would like to your answer as well. There are many innovation hubs around competence centers. I'm sure we have very excellent technology science solutions. I wonder whether the ecosystem or business development or, from the user perspective, how is it going? How we are going to measure this? I mean, are we on the right track? So I would like to know some information about the ongoing activities. So,
well, you asked me also to answer. That let me first tell you a little bit about the I4MS. And the I4MS started in 2013 and delivered already quite some digital or quite some competence centers, as Khalil already showed. And I think we are on the right track to take the next step with the digital innovation hubs. I can tell you that the concept of digital innovation hubs is still quite a little bit in its infancies, and it needs to be further developed. So there's no strict definition of this is a digital innovation hub. It's all a digital innovation hub is about aligning other competences than the technological expertise and the technological infrastructures, aligning that with business development. So that's what the digital innovation hub is. I think we are starting it up, and we are initiating, boosting the development of those in Europe. And looking also at some examples, there are already digital innovation up, whatever you might call them, popping up, created. So we are on our way, so to say. But that's my thought. Any other thoughts from the panelists? Luigi, can I ask you?
Well, we are in early stages, because the five hubs that I presented, they are just working now on their business plan. So in 6 months they will come out with a report to the Commission. But what is important is, in reality, is a business plan that has to identify how to connect. Most is how to better connect what is already in their territories, but the competences that are already in the ecosystem, but focus them in a way that they are able to provide concrete answers to the entrepreneurs that will come to their doors, knocking at the door, trying to find out many different things. How better I can sell my product, how can I make smarter product, how can I spend less money in producing this, how can I get better financing, how can I get a partner, etc. So there are different services, different competences that are going to be identified through this exercise, but a lot is already there. So In this way, as a label, let's say, as a service, as a new activity is new. We will work in the months to come in order to make a very good start of this new concept. But I am optimistic because it's based on things that are already there, that have been functioning for quite a while, but with a different twist towards digital innovation, all-round digital innovation, and not just technologies. I don't know if it's...
I think in Austria already there has been quite some investments in ICT development. So could you say something about what is going on in Austria at this moment also to create those digital innovation hubs?
I do completely agree because, so sorry for all engineers, but I think the technology is already here. The thing is about business models that we have to find. And I think that the digital innovation will completely change the way that my company, my competition, my customers, my partners will work together. It's a complete change. And I think this we have to manage. We are very good at technology all over Europe. But we have to have a mindset of working together. I think this has been stressed also in the two initiative statements. I think that's the main topic. So it's innovation hubs, it's more than technology. It's about cooperation and creating spaces where cooperation can take place. And I think that's one of the main goals. It starts at the national and regional level, and then we have to cooperate. So for Austria and for Carinthia, I can say we are cooperating with Italy, our technology parks, with Slovenia. And the people are so interested in this cooperation. And you learn from each other. And I think that's the most added value to digital innovation hubs.
Other questions? Yes, a lot of them.
That's good. Hi, I'm Silvia La Maza from Innovalia, working in the CSA for my firm. My question is to Mr. Perisic. Sorry, maybe not well pronounced. My question is, you've had explain us your... strategy towards innovation hubs, digital innovation hubs in Italy. And you have these five elected from the last call. So my question is, do you have foreseen some financial support or any other type of support after these 6 months are over within the Italian government?
Well, the government has presented on the 21st of September its strategy. So we will see the hubs on there, the competence centers too, more or less in line with the definition of the Commission. And that's not by chance, because we pushed, because we wanted to have some common view on these tools, and I think that's positive. They also included that these hubs and competence centers must be somehow connected to European network. I think also this is important, because otherwise we risk to fall back on sort of a national vision, and on this, on digitalization, would be, I think, a mistake. We have, the first thing we have done with our local associations when we decided to participate was to go to the region. Each one has gone to their region and say, listen, this is a project, this is a program, this is a vision. Do you agree? Are you ready to support us if we succeed? Because it was a call, so we were not sure they would succeed. If we succeed, are you willing to, do you agree with the strategy, and are you willing to support it? And they say yes, and they put it in writing. Okay, well, now we know that with public administration, it's a bit more complex than that. It's not like a contract. Okay, now give me 1 million, 10 million, 50 million, 100 million. I don't know. That's the Dutch, that's a division. We are a bit smaller for the time being. But anyway, this has been the starting point, because if there is not political commitment from the region, it's very difficult that you can succeed with an initiative that is rooted in the territory, that will have to cooperate, that will have to spread wings and work with all the other hubs in Italy and beyond. But you need to have a commitment at local level from the politicians and say, yes, we think that this is something that needs to be done. So we hope, now we have received a small, very small grant from the Commission to finance the business plan. We will finish March, April of next year. But in the meantime, there is already a close contact with the regions. The Piemonte region is already starting to set up new laws to support this type of action. The Marche region will do the same. The Lazio region will do the same. So we are working closely with the regions to be able that when the hubs will start, they will have some of the support they need in addition to the European support that they will believe, that I hope will continue. Thanks.
So Hans, just a follow-up question to Hans. How did you do that? How did you organize what Luigi is now talking about? How did you organize that?
It works now. Well, I will not say that we started about 7 years ago, so forget it. It was a very long way. For example, because manufacturing was not on the mental map in my region. It was about water technology or energy transition, but manufacturing was not recognized as one EU challenge. So we, first of all, we should put the manufacturing industry as the only one motor for jobs in the region, or the biggest motor for jobs. Yeah? What will happen? On the agenda of the local politicians, that was hard to do, but we finally succeeded. And your question was how, huh?
Yes.
Oh my God. well, for me, it's always important that you have a couple of guys, people, who will not sleep before it's ready. Huh? It's the Gideon's band. Perhaps that's Dutch, yeah? And in every project, the Gideon's band will be is necessary. Otherwise, I think it was important that we have a very clear vision developed together about what we understand as smart factories. And it's not the next step, because the next step can be done by companies themselves. It is the next 10 steps in a very short period. And everybody was convinced that it's completely impossible to do it themselves. For example, an average machine building company, I don't know if you know them, I know them, 40 people, family owned, very good in traditional machinery, asked them to build self-learning machines on their own. It's completely impossible. So you need to organize the cluster and the icons. And I think all this, what was very important in our project, in the way too, it's very much focused on the business case from the companies. Huh? That's the reason why they would invest in such a program. Huh?
Getting support from industry.
Otherwise, forget it. Huh? You will not get support if you ask them, let's think about the next smart factory.
So
and they say, you're a nice guy, but I will not invest. That's not how it works. Huh? Now we are now 1 year on our way. I think it's very important to do what we have told, but also to do other things. Huh? We have very much a front office and a back office strategy. A front office, just we execute what we promised to the regional government and to the companies. But that's okay. That's running automatically. We are very much focused to organize the breakthroughs. The collateral damage. Every project is the main thing is the collateral damage. And we are now, for example, we are now launching on Friday our first spin-off. It's called Edit. It's a smart factory as a shared service. That's really innovative. We organized 15 million euros to invest in a joint smart factory, and not producing in the supply chain, not producing yourselves, but as a consortium. And yeah. The theory is that Tesla, for example, will be able to to establish and exploit their own smart factory, but SMEs won't. It's completely impossible. The investments are much too high, so you should find another way to organize manufacturing in the future. For SMEs, so that's a breakthrough. So we did not promise breakthroughs, but in the ghost of the team at this Gideon's band.
Okay, thank you. Jobs, industry participation, spin-outs.
Hello, Jean-Philippe Bourgoin, Head Corporate Strategy from CEA France. My question is about the best way to incentivize the development of innovation hubs. Should it be ex ante, in the form of a project that is subsidized and then happens what happens, or in an ex post way, where success calls for a bit more money to accelerate? So the question is two level, based on the experience of the speaker and about the reflections that may be about this subject at the EU level.
Who can I give the floor? Rafael?
So I think maybe both. Maybe both. I mean, you need ex ante and ex post also. So, but because, I mean, you need to start, I mean, with the innovation hub and just observing some different results. And after, I mean, when the program is success, of course, you can put some condition ex ante. But, I mean, previously, at least in our case, so in our innovative hubs, I mean, the works, I mean, are success. So now we can put some condition ex ante just for, I mean, directing or addressing the companies just for doing something. So maybe both. I mean, so it's interesting. So when the initiative, I mean, is starting and developing, so you can get or you can put some ex ante condition just for addressing these companies or I mean the different networking ecosystem.
Khalil, would you like to respond?
Yeah, just say that probably. You've realized that this, I mean, it's not new what we're talking about here, i.e. competence centers, transferring technology. Technology transfer is something we all know about as part of the innovation process. But what is new here is the, I think what was mentioned, the three features that were mentioned by the speakers based on their experience. What is new here is that we're making technology available not for the suppliers, the usual guys we talk to, but they're very important. They're good, and they will supply IT technologies. And this is a large majority of the technology transfer goes to software development companies, to new startups that will come up with a new service on the web, etc. That's good, and will continue. But we're adding to it this dimension of all industrial sectors coming and innovating in ICT. This is new, and that comes from connection. The larger network of stakeholders, this is exactly what was mentioned here. And that connection and trust that you establish with all industries to come and test and try these new technologies, and based on absolutely their needs. I totally agree with what Hans said. I mean, if they don't have a need and they don't feel it, that there is something that they could do here, you cannot drag them and give them all the money, you will lose it, because ultimately they'll not be exploited. So that connection is very important. I think that's the key feature of what is proposed here. That's, you know, connection between various types of stakeholders, providers of ICT, technology owners, users, mainly from all industrial sectors. I think these are features. Now, how to start, should it be, you know, in a region ex ante, we think a project, a new project, and we start, frankly, from the experience we saw, it can work. And I agree, it depends on humans. I think that's the third feature. It depends on humans. And, when we look at Europe, there are very important labs that created somewhere we think never would be there. And they're world leaders. They become world leaders and attract investments from all across the world. And they're, you know, envied by worldwide. Because there were individual teams at regional level, development level, thought, well, why don't we create it, coming from the universities or whatever? Why don't we create a new center and we create a cluster around it and it works? So the individual willingness, et cetera, sometimes it's more structured, it's part of regional development policy or national development policy, and it can work. That could work. It could also be, you know, you have a wonderful center, a center that is embryonic, with excellent team, let's grow it. Why not? Why not? I don't think there is one methodology. The importance is to be aware of the characteristics of the regions and what you can do with it. I think this is the success factor. And being able to respond to the region that you could see here from the various examples there. So I'm sorry it was long, but I took this opportunity to explain a bit more than your question of what we're trying to do here.
Last question, perhaps, before we take a little bit of a sip from a coffee.
Okay. I'm Vanessa Ricci. I work for the Agency for SMEs and the European Commission. We fund the most innovative SMEs thanks to the SME instrument. It was unfortunately not mentioned before. But my question is, on the basis of the experience that we have with SMEs, to think about one of the main problems for SMEs is the access to finance. So innovation hubs, excellent. We have a lot of SMEs that they pass the threshold to get funded, but we don't have enough funds to fund them, and they receive just a seal of excellence. They go back to the region, and they don't manage to get funded. So maybe already you can do something for them in your region and take these champions in your hub. That would be already something. And just as a general advice, please promote as much as possible your activities at national level so that the SMEs, you can reach these SMEs to come to you and to have your support at national level when we cannot provide at European level. We can only fund 7% of these 10,000 applications per year. So
I think Gaby could say something about that, because I know that there's venture capitalists, there's a thought about the venture capitalists in Austria.
First of all, we want to get as much European money as we can get. I think it's true for everybody here on the panel, and I think it's one drive for working together. Our region has got a contract with Excel, so that's one thing. We try to combine companies, so one of them would be too small to get part of the program or to be part of the program, so we have to combine them. And I think it's one driving force also for big players and for small players to work together to be able to participate. And I think it's a good idea, because it forces to work together. It has to be on a certain level to be international seen. The second thing, you also have to help small companies to start. And for politicians, it's always very hard to set venture capital. We right now try to establish a fund for venture capital, but we have to work together also with industry, and we have to work together to make a mindset. Because if 1 out of 10 succeeds, it's perfect. And it's always hard to argue that you give money from taxes in things that might not be a success. So venture capital is a theme also on regional level, but I think it's hard to argue, but it's worth it. Because when I think of Carinthia, we have got startups which now attract international investors. Nobody would have thought of it. And they are doing great work. So if nobody would fund these startups, there would be no excellence in different fields. So we have to try to find the solutions. And we talked about it earlier. There are examples. And you don't always need to invent everything on your own. If there are regulations, you can take and make the best of it. We should really try it. And I would love to visit the Field Factory.
Yes.
Okay. Is it possible?
Okay.
Sorry to imposing my question. Digital hubs implies digital skills. Well, I'm one of the companies that we are a SME Horizon champion, so we are funded by the European Commission. By the way, that we are narrowing the gap between what the companies are looking for in terms of digital skills and what we can do by training them and employing them. The panel, do you have a guess how many jobs are currently vacant because there are no qualified professionals in Europe? Do you have a guess nowadays?
I
Yeah, but how many jobs in Europe are vacant nowadays because there are no qualified professionals?
Not exactly, but
there's roughly 1 million, huh? Roughly 1 million jobs. Yeah. So the topic is
we will not manage to cope this problem. Huh?
Exactly. So my question would
as
be
as we expect the current schools, huh?
Yeah.
If they should solve the problem. Forget it. They will not manage to solve the problem.
Since we started the
and
discussion,
and it's much bigger than everyone in this. Yeah, perhaps you know it. Realize that the director of the company next direct is IT, and all the people are IT persons, even on the low scale level. And I fully agree.
Yes, I can tell you that.
300,000 jobs have been created.
I don't know how to. I don't know. Perhaps in my town we have a very bottom-up initiative, Eternity, organized by youngsters themselves. No money at all. They don't need the structure that all the parents are developing and dreaming about. and I expect more completely out of the regular schools.
Glad to discuss it with you.
Okay.
Perhaps also to get it connected to the digital innovation hubs again, within the concept of digital innovation hubs, training and education is a very important element. Because what we see is the development of a hub that connects research to business also needs to be accompanied by activities that can train the personnel that are spinned out with those new businesses towards SMEs. So that's an important element to the concept. I am thinking about time also. Perhaps Luigi, you can
very quick,
finalize
very quick.
This.
No, I cannot. I just wanted to react to the intervention of SME program. I think that another thing is very important we have to do, and the Commission has to help us to do, is to use the hubs also to connect the EU initiatives. At the first meeting of our hub in Rome, one of the members of the European Enterprise Network came, and he said, listen, we have a database of SMEs all over Lazio that are innovative, etc. Welcome, bring them to us, let us know who they are, and we'll start working with them. And the same thing is, I tell you, because it is true at regional level, we can activate also regional funds that could go in a priority way to companies that has passed the very hard and high quality testing that you do in Europe, you know, through your programs, etc. We have the same problem with the Horizon 2020 projects that are not funded and they have a top score. They should be funded also at national level. So I think this is a road to follow, and thank you for the suggestion.
So just very quickly wrapping up this discussion right now within this panel, I think my main conclusion is that we need to go to the coffee break because there's a lot to discuss. And we are only scratching the surface of what digital innovation hubs are and what they can mean. I think jobs creation is the last thing, but not the least thing, but also other activities, how to fund SMEs, all those discussions. Please go on a coffee break. And please be back in about 15 minutes. Can I ask you to sit down? We would like to start again, and I'm sure the coffee break was very useful, but still we've got a second panel discussion. Eve, could you organize that the right things are? Yes.
Is that yours?
Yeah, but this was one. Okay, and we can start our second panel discussion. I see that quite a few people have left. It has a plus side and it has a negative side. The negative side is a shame that they're gone, but the plus side is that the level of discussions can be a little bit more intensive. So that's good, that's good. Can I ask the panelists to sit on the chairs? So Ms. Susanna Nehajova, I'm horrible at pronouncing names. Cecilia Dunbury, Jean-Marie Spaus, and Lina Huertas. So just a very quick introduction. I'm sure that IT can help us with this. Just a very short introduction of our panelists, and then very quickly, I would suggest again into the discussion. So Ms. Susanna Nehajova is the advisor to the Ministry of Economics, so that's quite interesting, in Slovakia. And she has also a law and master degrees in financial management, and that's, again, a little bit of a different perspective on things. But she is responsible for the national strategy for supporting innovation clusters and startups, improving the business environment and digital economy. This is from your own CV, I think. And that's great, because that's what Innovation Hubs is all about. And especially her experience with the private sector is, I think, quite interesting. So, Susanna, the floor is yours. So what you can do is just grab the microphone and the IT people will get you some. Yeah, the slide is behind you now.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me here today. It's my pleasure to discuss such an important topic. Firstly, I would like to say that Industry 4.0 and all this digitizing of industry, these terms have been still perceived as a threat by many. But I think we shouldn't be creating the bubble about smart industry and digitization. I think we really have to understand that innovation was here 50 years ago, and it will be here in 100 years. So it's not really up to us if we're going to be innovative, if we're going to implement these new trends. We need to innovate products, we need to innovate services, we need to innovate businesses. Otherwise, we won't be able to keep up with our competitors. We have to realize that. And actually, this holds true not only for companies. This holds true for universities and definitely for government. We have very interesting Slovak startup developing the artificial intelligence, and I'm sure they would be much more happy to discuss with you the artificial intelligence governing the state instead of us. So let's see how would that work and who would be better. I think understanding the importance of innovative hubs and this inclusivity of the stakeholders was the reason why we have decided to develop the smart industry strategy for Slovakia in a close cooperation as a joint venture of academia, of industry, and of government representatives. I think the aim of this smart industry strategy for Slovakia is exactly the facilitation of the cooperation of those relevant stakeholders. So as we would be able to strengthen the industry by enabling them to make full use of the latest technology development, but also to help them to adapt to this change that this transformation is actually bringing.
It is actually anchored in all these six pillars in the Smart Industry Strategy for Slovakia. And I promise I'm not going to go through all of them. It could take us a lot of time. But yes, all of these actions are important. They're equally important. We have to be working on all of them in cooperation. What I would like to stress out, when we started with the Smart Industry for Slovakia, we realized that many stakeholders, they already do understand the terms. You would be surprised, also those stakeholders within the government do understand the term, the terminology. However, in sort of an isolated manner. The emphasis was not put on the cooperation, not the, linkage of new trends, both national and European level, and not actually including all the relevant stakeholders that I think was really needed. I think we have to understand that smart industry is not only on industry leaders, it's not only on digital ventures. We have to include university, we have to include R&D institutions, we have to include startups and scale-ups, because those are the companies that are innovative, that are flexible, and can actually complement the, market dynamics. You can just take very quickly the examples of Silicon Valley, I think. Behind this, you know, contemporary Silicon Valley where failure and success, they are both celebrating as a learning exercise. There is actually great history of academic entrepreneurship, governmental R&D support, and also all the other relevant ecosystem elements, such as venture capital firms. I would say that this triple helix knowledge model for regional development, we know that it's been tried from MIT cooperation after Great Depression in the 1930s, but this is something that's been actually also transported to the North California, where it sort of reinforced this organically and independently originated process of knowledge-based economy and social development. And I think all of us know that Silicon Valley from this regional hub has actually became this node of global network, attracting all the European companies or many European companies. But they do not have to leave exactly because of the cooperation that we are trying to create, that the European Commission is trying to create through the digital innovative hubs, but also through national strategies that we have that we have developed together. Digital innovation hubs can serve as sort of this experimental lab field for testing the new developments, new technology, for bringing innovative products, innovative processes, but also creating new business models and actually creating new markets, because this is what innovation should be doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, from my perspective, it's very good to see a smart industry agenda, because I was involved in the development of the smart industry agenda in the Netherlands. So I feel that we are brother and sister there. So, I think from my side, it's very interesting to hear what kind of nitty gritty things there were in the development in such a strategy and what the problems there was. But let's keep that for later on. Ms. Cécile Dembery is the next speaker. Educated at the École Nationale Supérieure des Télécommunications. It was very luckily that the ENST was as an abbreviation. But you need to switch on the microphone, I think. What struck me there was that you've got really the your foots in the telecommunication part, and that's quite interesting. Now you're the DG director and within the Ministry of Economics, so I'm sure you can tell us a lot more about digital innovation hubs in France. Please.
Yeah, thank you very much. Digitalization of industry and services are very at the center of the French policy. In France, we have 3 million of companies, and more than 90% of them are SMEs. So SMEs are really an issue for us. And the problem we are facing that is when people are very well equipped, or at least rather well equipped with digital tools in France, SMEs don't know how to use them. And to address this problem, we have set up during the past years a whole set of programs to address different issues. We have two programs which are transverse, and other programs we are more focused on technological aspects. The first program is focused on industrial companies. It deals with SMEs, but not only, it's industry in the future. The aim is to encourage the SMEs and the company in general to modernize the modern tools and to digitalize the process. For doing that, we have a special action dedicated to SMEs. In these actions, the public local authority fund advisors to help these SMEs to set up a diagnosis to how they can improve the process, how they can change the productive tools. And after this diagnosis has been set up, the government, through BPI, BPI is a public bank of investment, grant them loans so they can implement the projects that they have. It has to do, of course, with robotizations, but not only. The purpose is really to digitalize all the supply chain in the companies itself, but with all the interaction it has with the other companies it can deal with. Another program is Transition Numérique, which is mean digital transition. This one is designed for very small businesses. I mean shopkeepers, artisans, and most of the time, these very small businesses have no knowledge of digital at all, or very, very poor knowledge. So with this program, we try to teach them, to sensibilize them to very basic digital aspects like e-commerce, website, how to use cloud computing. And for doing that, we relied on a network of 1,000 advisories, and these advisors are in a local competence center. These are the two transverse programs, but we have also more technological programs, which are innovations hub. We have one on simulations using HPC, we have one on big data, we have another one to teach SMEs how to put nanoelectronics and embedded software in their products, and so on. I've mentioned that we have financial support, one from the BPI, of course, SMEs part of the Industry of the Future program can benefit from them, but in fact, any SMEs can apply to these loans granted by BPI. We have 300 million euro of loans for doing that. What I'd like to stress out in our programs is first that we had to design different programs to address different problems, one for industry, one for very small businesses, and specific programs for technological aspect. The other things I'd like to share with you is that we are currently doing a review of our programs with the Conseil National du Numérique, which is an advisory body to the government on all the digital matters. And what this review has shown is first that it's very important to address the CRO and raise its awareness concerning digital problems. If you want to modernize SME, you have to convince the CEO of the benefit and the importance of digital. It has been said in the previous roundtable, digitalizing SME is much more difficult than digitalizing a big company. The other things we learned from this review is that we had to process in a very operating way, and I mean that we must accompany SME in a very, very concrete way, giving them diagnoses, very helping them to set up a project. The third point is that if you want to succeed, you need to have financial support so they can set up their project. And the last point, the importance of communications. Communication, have to have good communication, and right now our program in France are lacking communication, so people don't know them very well, and we are thinking of having a logo or something like that to make them the program more clear and to promote them and to have more impact on everybody.
Well, thank you. What strikes me is the very systematic way of organizing these things. So it's not only helping SMEs with competences centers of, with competences, but also addressing loans and also expertise, helping them with expertise. I think that's very much connected to the idea of digital innovation hubs. And I'm looking forward for all the questions and that we can learn a little bit more from you about how to organize that. Our next speaker is Jean-Marie Spaus. He's a project manager from the Ministry of Industry in Luxembourg. But perhaps it's even more interesting to say that he was the director for the Post Telecommunication, which is the parent organization of Post Luxembourg. And from that industrial point of view, he was appointed as the coordinator of the IPSE Initiative for High Performance Computing and Big Data. And what he is right now developing together with some other countries, stakeholders in countries. And Jean-Marie, please tell us a little bit about it and tell us about your early lessons learned.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Indeed, it is a pleasure for me to present our initiative today. It's an initiative that has been recently launched by four countries, France, Italy, Spain, and Luxembourg. And this is an initiative that has as objective to for democratization of HPC and big data-enabled applications. So what does that mean, democratization of HPC and big data? I think we heard already in the first panel the industry will be digital tomorrow, but it's already starting, and we have to move forward. We have to move very fast forward. So our initiative is to bring HPC into the cloud, and not just doing a copy of what is existing today, but we want to use first European technology as much as possible. We want to move up to exascale technology, and we want to develop applications, because applications, that's the user interface, that's where, let's say, raw data streams are converted into economic value. So it's very important. I think this reflection brought us to including these three pillars into our initiatives. Having the infrastructure, I will speak a little bit about the ecosystem we want to build. Having the exascale technology and making them available to the industry, to SMEs, that's what we call democratization. And finally, the applications that are needed, that are relevant for the industry, and to help them to be more competitive in a digital single market, the market that is now prepared by the European Commission, and to help them and to establish a level playing field for all the industry that want to participate in that digital single market. So first objective is creating this ecosystem. So we want to bring together all the actors. When I say ecosystem, it's not only technology. You explained it very well, showing us the value chain from A to Z. So we have to work on the European value chain. We already learned that the technology is there. We have the infrastructure, we have data centers, we have broadband connectivity, we have software engineers. Let's bring that together. Let's bring that into the cloud. And of course, then the soft skills. We have to build trust. We have to build security to make it happen that the industry adopts giving their data into this virtualized environment, and that can only be done when we build trust. Our objective is then, of course, to have the complete integration of European components to build the exascale technology. Again, the technology is there. Of course, we have to work on a new processor. We have to work on integrating that. We have to work on new middleware to make it happen, but it's possible. It's a long-term approach, but as I said, the technology is there. And finally, then we have to build the applications, because the applications, they are relevant for the industry. They have to know how to turn raw data streams into value, into valuable information that can be use to create new services, new digital services that can help startups, SMEs, or even well-established companies to create new services and bring this to the market. So that is, in a nutshell, the project that we have. And when I can try to bring it together in one phrase, in one sentence, is it's a project from industry for industry. So we have to integrate the European industries to build our project together. And I think a very important word here is the co-designed approach. We have to build this together, co-design it together, and make it happen. And yes, I think that's the spirit of our IPCI project. Thank you very much.
What I find interesting here is that you're from industry, but you're now located and positioned at a ministry level in Luxembourg. So you're working for the ministry in Luxembourg, but you're still for industry from industry. So that's an interesting approach, and it connects very well to our panel discussion later on, what the involvement of national governments is in establishing digital innovation hubs. So now our last speaker, Lina Huertas from the Manufacturing Technology Center. She is educated in, you're not educated in Loughborough University, but you did make the shift, I think, there to the more NTC-oriented activities. She is now technology manager in intelligent automation and informatics at the MTC. The MTC might be seen as one of the examples, the good examples of a digital innovation hub. And I'm sure she will be able to tell us a lot about what kind of problems the MTC faced and what kind of influences the government had on establishing a beautiful catapult center like the MTC. Lina.
Thank you, Maurits. And thanks for the invitation. I want to tell you about the story of the MTC and some lessons learned. How did we make it happen? So hopefully... To start, thank you. See if I make this work. Good. It's rare that it works. Yes. So if you think about the UK about 10 years ago when I landed there, it was known more for financial services and services in general. So a job in manufacturing was the least glamorous thing you could do, which is what I did. And then the crisis came, so the government commissioned a report to understand, how can we refuel the economy in the UK? That was the Herman Hauser report, and what the recommendation for that report was to set up a set of centres that were called the Catapult Centres. Now, what the Catapult Centres do is basically transfer technology to industry. We have world-class research, we have world-class industry, but we're not very good at transferring innovation into industry. And that's what we set up to do, but it's a little bit more than that. So, starting from the beginning, we had, just talking about numbers, we had an initial investment of £40 million to create the MTC, and that in entailed the buildings, the infrastructure. Infrastructure is very important, so we're not just a building. A real capital is all the skills, so the engineers that we have working there, but also infrastructure in terms of real industrial equipment, because we can test solutions and test that it actually works in industry if we have a comparable environment. That's very important. We had follow-on funding, and we also get annual funding from government. So we started as MTC, but we have several other things around it. As I said, that entails skills and infrastructure. We were funded by four universities as well as industry, and they're part of our partnership. They're part of our ecosystem, and ecosystem has, the word has been mentioned a few times today and is very, very important. This can't happen without an ecosystem. So universities are very important. That's where new ideas are coming from. But we also count with an industrial membership of about 100 members. Some of them are technology providers, some of them are end users, and those people, those partners, are the ones that make this happen. So we work with end users to understand what are their issues and then work together with academia and technology partners to make that jump across. This is how we started. Now, then we became part of the high-value manufacturing catapult network. We're 7 centers. That happened very soon after the MTC happened. So we're part of 7 centers who do similar activities but complementary skills. So some of them focus, for example, on composites, others on forming. Then, about 3 years after starting with the MTC, we started to realize that skills were something so important for this topic that we set up a separate center, a separate subsidiary company. It's called the Advanced Manufacturing Training Center. And what we do there is look at all the topic around skills, what are the job descriptions of the future, how do we train apprentices, people from universities, but also how do we retrain people who are already in industry. And we also created something called the Business Launch Center, again, another subsidiary within the MTC group. And what they look at is how do we transfer technology then into industry? Because you can create a great technology solution, but that doesn't mean that it's going to be adopted into industry. There are a lot of successful projects where, due to cultural change, end up being not successful. So Business Launch Center looks at almost the second valley of death, we call it, and is how do we really make technology adoption happen? So if you look at that, we have almost a triangle of 3 things that are really key to what we do. Research and strategy is key to what we do, but we also look at education and training and business support. So this was probably up until 3 years ago. Now we're starting to look at how do we complement that ecosystem with things that may take us further or may take UK industry further, really. So we're starting to work on policy, particularly on the digital angle, but also other angles such as additive manufacturing. And we're starting to inform the government and help the government set national initiatives in these areas. We're also looking at finance. And for example, one interesting thing that happened is the Advanced Manufacturing Training Center was funded by the Lloyds Bank in the UK. So suddenly banks reacted and realized that they actually need to go and work together with SMEs and help industry to be more effective. So they're starting to get together. We're starting to work together with them to set up finance mechanisms that are more relevant. And we're starting to work on national colleges. We're one of the first national colleges in the UK that's linked to skills again and training and working closely together with other catapult centers. Perhaps the most relevant one for this environment is the digital catapult. So as you can see, we started as a competence center, I would say, look at innovation, but now we're starting to cover more areas to provide more impact into industry. Now, I started talking about funding and how much came from the government. That was absolutely necessary, but it's also very important that there is support from industry. So if you look at it now at our funding model, around 37%, that's for a high-value manufacturing catapult, comes from industry. But for the MTC, I would say it's around 43%. So we started with a lot of government funding, but you can see how now industry is starting to also invest in technology, invest in new solutions, invest into innovation. And that's what makes it really relevant, because it can't be just government support. And we made last year an economic study, and what it showed is that for every pound invested in the high-value manufacturing catapult, we're generating £15 of impact in the UK economy. And that's really what makes it relevant, because we're not only having a huge impact in industry, but also, if I think about it today in comparison to 10 years ago, I have a team of around 25 people that actually think that a job in manufacturing or digital manufacturing is pretty glamorous and very excited about these types of projects. So it's a real change. Thank you.
So the first thought that enters into my mind is, they're leaving us. Brexit. They're leaving us.
couldn't get away without that question.
No, that's not a question, it's just a thought of mine. And the second thought I have is jealousy. So how many of you are jealous about this? Raise your hands.
They're all
I am. So thank you, Lena, for sharing this this idea. So now it's up to you. And you can ask some questions now anymore. I've got a lot of them, but I'm sure you've got them also. Please state your name and organization, and then... Yes.
Sanju Garani from Funding Box. We're involved in 4 feasibility studies of digital innovation hubs across Europe. Since you mentioned the glamorous point and 10 years ago and now, also regarding the gender equality element, and I've seen the videos on your website, but maybe you can say something about how that also helped girls or women get into STEM.
It's an interesting question. First, I'm really glad to be in a panel of 3 women, and one blessed between us. I mean, it's an interesting topic. There's definitely a lot more women in engineering now. I'd say I'm pretty privileged. I work in a department where probably about 20-25% are women. They're pretty visionary and intelligent, bright, capable women. In a way, that's the exception. In other areas, it may be as low as 8%. I'm not sure how much the topic of digital has made a difference. In some areas, it has made a difference because careers more like computer science or perhaps things related to more principled technologies or other sciences are now merging with engineering or design, for example, is another one that's becoming more relevant in the field of digital technologies, and that has made an impact. But I don't think it's just digital that's making an impact. I think it's more a general change in engineering.
I think we don't have to worry that much because look at the panel. 3 women. But I would like to ask you also the same question. Can you, Susanna, could you say something about the diversity and in this initiative?
Well, I can, about the diversity, of course. We're trying to support that. I'm really glad that we're sitting here like this. However, I have to say that this is not really the case often. So I think we have to do much more in this regard. Have to support women and girls, diversity in general. If I may just add also to what had been already said also before, I think the strategies as such are being very similar. They are also, you all asked about what sort of lessons learned would we have from the strategy and from our work, from our previous work. A lot has been said about financing, about government financing the companies. But without providing smart money, it's not going to work. So if we're just going to provide financing for any project in as grants or in any forms, any other forms, if we don't provide knowledge through forms such as Digital Innovation Hub or any other platform, we won't succeed. So I think we have to be very careful about that. For the skills as such, not only talking about digital skills, and now not only girls or, of course, securing the diversity, look at the energy sector, look at the, electrotechnic in these areas. I think we really have to start anticipating the future needs. And again, Innovation Hub platforms can serve as sort of source for information for the government, how to secure that the industry needs would be secured also in future. So how to secure the future needs of the industry, not only the digital ones. And of course, I would be very much supportive if we can also come up with tools how to promote this diversity, how to promote these parents that are now lawyers and managers and trying to send the kids only to manage another lawyers, trying to send them to technological fields, to study technological fields.
Broader answer. Okay, thank you. I want to point out, like my colleagues, that it's the first time we are 3 women. Usually when I go to nano-electronic forums or frequency forums, we are just
maybe one or two women. But diversity is not a question of women and men, it's more wider than that, and I'd like to present you an initiative we have in France, which is called La Grande École du Numérique, which is trying to be an answer of the lack of not engineer, but technical people who have technical knowledge in digital. What we do, we give not, I don't know the name in English, label. I know there's no name in English, like a support, but not in a financial support, like we recognize the formation, special formation, which what we call décrocheurs. It's people who can't follow the usual courses in high school or in school and are a part of the scholarship system. And we try to promote this new kind of way of educate people so that more people can have access to digital skills. And it can be online, but it can be also special places that more people can have access to all this technology and after be some kind of manpower in companies. And it's very important to have this new innovative system to have new manpower.
Thank you. And Jean-Marie, would you like to comment on it, or?
No, maybe I want to add another dimension about, society and diversity. I think when we speak about digital societies, about services, and I think, and I fully agree what I heard, education is, you can teach, let's say, digital via, as we learned it in the old school, via maths and numerical maths and whatever, or via the services or the entrepreneurial side. And I think here, girls and everybody who has ideas, who is creative, wants to realize that. And I think it's the approach, and the approach has changed a lot. And this is due also to the evolution of technology. Writing, let's say, a code today is easier or different than it was 20 years ago. So the approach is different. First, you have an idea, you want to develop your idea, and I think that's a huge motivation factor, independently who you are and where you come from. I think that's an additional point I wanted to add.
Thank you. I've got a question over there.
Hello to everybody. My name is Julius Kraviar. I am from Slovak Center of Scientific and Technical Information. I have two short questions for Jean-Marie. You spoke about European exascale strategy, and I would like to know what is the difference between this strategy and European Open Science Cloud? That's the first question.
Should I answer directly on that?
Yes.
Okay.
The second question is there in the European Commission the policy how to implement such big e-infrastructures? Because there is a big difference if the infrastructure will be in Spain or will be in Sweden. We can pay for operational costs one, or we can pay four for the same job. So let's two questions. Thank you.
Okay, maybe I start with the second question or give you an answer on that. First of all, our idea is that we have distributed resources. So the idea is not having, let's say, everything everywhere, but having the best on specific places where you have the competence to drive it. That means that it is a truth that today, let's say, countries have specific skills on specific, and it is depending on their history, on their industry that is existing now. So this is very important. You have to use the history that is there. So there you have, the competence to make a very fast step into to bring that industry, that specific industry, into the digital age. So we want to take profit out of that. And I think that is maybe also the first, or an answer to the first question. We want to move fast. We want to bring, profit to the industry, and especially to start up small and medium-sized companies as fast as possible. So you have to use the knowledge, the know-how that is there in industry, And the only way to do it today is to federate the knowledge that is existing. So that's the basis of our reflection. But because today, and you are right, infrastructures in Europe are still too fragmented, and we have to bring it together. So we have to develop a kind of platform, an access platform, so that everybody who has today a broadband connection can access that technology. It's a challenge. You know, HPC technologies, simulation technologies, numerical technologies, they are complicated today. So we have to bring it to a level, let's say that a user, it still has to be a skilled user, but having very good IT skills can access that technology and can use it. You can compare it. For me, let's say, you said it, I'm coming from the telco industry, and I've been working 20 years or more than 20 years in the telco industry. So I was there when the first internet access was done until now. During that time, something like a browser did not exist. But a browser was a tool, democratization of the internet. And we have to do the same step here again on the application level. If we can meet that challenge, if we can solve it, I think we can really give broad access or broaden the access to this technology. Technology so urgently needed by the industry because they need this computing power. We are now on a step of evolution that everybody says there will be the big data phenomenon. IoT will create a lot of data, so we have to capture that data. We have to structure that data to make economic value out of that. And on the same time, let's say we have to organize computing power. And because computing power becomes an essential resource compared like electricity or water. So we have to take that into consideration and bring this to, let's say, to the industries, to the companies, to young entrepreneurs, somebody who has a great idea about, hasn't developed a good algorithm. But he should give that to a platform and he can create his company on that. So that's the idea. And that's the spirit behind our IPCI. It's not multiplying infrastructure. It's first of all using what is there, federating it, bring it together, taking the competence out of that competence center where it exists, and bring it to the user. That's the spirit of our initiative.
Thank you. The first question was about the...
It's not a difference. It's we want to use this technology. We want to work together with all the programs, all the initiatives that already exists, because we want to be fast. So we have to work together. So co-design. We have to use the technology, the knowledge that has been developed. But using means integrated into our project. It's not an creating a complete new initiative. It's bringing the knowledge that has been developed to the user. That's our mission.
So combination, I'm sure, also with other initiatives on HPC supported by the I4MS will also be connected. I've got a question over here.
Jürgen Neises, Fujitsu. Considering HPC and IPCI again, we heard a lot about try and failure in businesses. So is there any kind of idea with this IPCI to go into a kind of simulation of business models supporting SMEs? And a second question, there are lots of initiatives. We have the Dutch initiative, the Austrian, the Slovakian, the German, the French, the Spanish, and so on, the British. And is there, or how shall these initiatives be coordinated? We are talking about digitizing European industry and not just member states' industries. Thanks.
So the first question about HPC. And please, Khalil, prepare yourself.
Yes, the business cases. I think we are now in an area where the business case are changes. Business cases will influence, let's say, our initiative. Today, classical, you have to invest in huge infrastructures and you have to replace it every 5 years. This model will not work anymore in the future, especially when we discuss a lot about entrepreneurs, new companies, startups. They do not have the financial means to replace, or first of all, to invest and then replace every 5 years their ICT infrastructure, or HPC infrastructure, or developing specific softwares for a specific job. So we have to mutualize infrastructures, we have to mutualize software, and that's the idea. So we want to bring these softwares into the cloud, we want to change business models, we have to, let's be clear, because, again, I come back from my telco background, so you know exactly how business models in the telco industry changed. Now, we are, let's say, in the beginning of an area where these business models, again, will change, and that's why we have to work very close together with people that have knowledge in the domain of business case. I'm thinking about, for example, the European Investment Bank, which are part of our project. We have to talk to these people. We have to understand the direction where the market goes. So market studies, the feeling of the market needs are very important. So that's extremely important on that.
If I may comment on that, I'm not sure if you meant business cases to invest in simulation and HPC or simulation to generate business cases. But on that point, then, one of the key things we're doing in the UK is that exactly that, using simulation to create business cases. But it's not highly demanding types of simulation, so you wouldn't need HPC. We usually do discrete event simulation, and it's very important because that's where we've done analysis for new factories where they say, for example, well, we think we need 3 production lines and this is our plan. We go, we simulate it, and we say, well, actually, you can get away only with 1 production line, and here is the evidence. This is based on your data. And they suddenly can, by investing, say, £10,000 or €10,000 or maybe a bit more, some government funding, they can save hundreds and thousands of pounds in capital investment for future plans.
Maybe I want to, or Khalil, maybe he will, because the question came from the European industry. For us, therefore, it's very important that we work very closely together with the European Commission and with relevant people there, because that's right, it's an European idea, because the program is open, it's open to other member states, it's open to other industries, they can join the program, but maybe I'll leave Khalil the floor to answer that question.
Khalil, before I give you the microphone, I'm going to take the advantage of being the moderator to tell a little bit about your second question about pan-European networking. Because I am the coordinator also of the Access to IFRMS project, which is a CSA, set up a mentoring program to support the development of digital innovation hubs in Europe. That's one of our activities. We are thinking about a pan-European network there. And also within the smart industry agenda in the Netherlands, there are coordinating mechanisms there. It's going to be platforms, they're going to be sharing of expertise and these kind of things. But it's still very preliminary, and how to further develop that into a broader pan-European network, that's still the question. But Khalil, it's up to you now.
Yeah, well, thanks for the question. I'll come back to this. It's one of the key issues that we're trying to address in this initiative. If you look at, I don't remember my slides at the beginning, one of the 5 actions, and it's in fact one of the most important actions that we have proposed, is this coordination framework, we call it. We call it dynamic coordination framework between national initiatives and EU initiatives. And we have described how this could work. We're setting up a roundtable of representatives of national initiatives that would come from the public side, and also when there is a national initiative with governance implying the private side, also the private side. And this roundtable meets twice per year. The first meeting was on the 20th, so last week of September. It's chaired by the commissioner, and it's very high level, discussing how to bring together these various initiatives and what can we learn from each other, because there is a lot to be done. And learning from each other, we're trying to do that right now. So learning from each other and identifying what can we do together, what needs to be done at national level, at regional level, and what is to be done together at EU level as well. So there are things that can be done together without necessarily going up to EU level, at multilateral level, etc. So this is what this roundtable would do. And it's not only two meetings per year where we talk, we have working and implementation in between. We have working groups that we've set up. We have a working group on innovation hubs where representatives of national initiatives on innovation hubs come together. First meeting is on 20th of October. And we have also working groups on the leadership issue. So which areas should we co-invest together? Research, development, innovation, testing, experimentation, standardization, rollout of the technology. We just issued a 5G action plan that shows how this could be done. We've done something similar in micro and nanoelectronics together, member states and us, investing in this field, where we went from R&D down to testing large-scale pilots to pilot lines of production down to an IPCI on micro nanoelectronics for production. We're engaging now in HPC. These are what I call the man to the moon projects, where together with the member states we could do something for leadership. But it's not only this. And we're setting a working group on this, see which areas we can co-invest together, which areas need to be done only at national level, etc. So this is part of how can we bring all these together. We're also having a large stakeholder forum where we go beyond these working groups, beyond national initiatives, to bring in other actors. This is part of this process to bring in, and that will be at the end of January 2017. So you see, we're putting in place a process to bring in together, to bring together these various initiatives. Keep in mind, I mean, not everything needs to be done together. A lot of things need to be done at member state level, but we can learn a lot from each other. And if you look at what we've done in I4MS, for example, or in these digital innovation hubs that we started, with these two actions that started almost a year or 2 years ago, we come and see what can we bring through this collaboration, knowing that a lot of the investments need to be done at regional level, at national level. We show how cross-border cooperation can bring value. Now, you've seen the examples, and how the connection between the competence centers can bring a one-stop shop service to industry by ensuring that each center has excellence, complementing these excellence to bring in a complete service to industry. So that's what we do at EU level. So just to give you an example of how we implement this cooperation. It's a key part of what we're proposing. It's not coming from us, really. It's coming from what member states told us and industry told us.
I think Victor would like to respond also.
Yeah, what an interesting question and a true question. Indeed, I think the government are the last one to find out that when we refer to the digital sector, we do not have borders anymore. The industry works together across Europe. Entrepreneurs work together. A skilled person can move to any European country. Only the governments do not know that. They make national policies, sometimes policies that contradict each other, and they forget to work together. Why is that? This is due to the fact that we don't know at European level who has the competence. Who has the competence on digital policies? Normally, and this is my vision, the European Union has to have the entire competence on handling such issues. But for the time being, we do not know who has, because it's a new topic. This is what governments usually say. And indeed, because of that, we do not find common solutions. There are people in the European Commission, like is the case here, who are working a lot to, you know, to avoid this idea of divided competence, to find solutions, to push for a European-wide policy, but it's hard. This is why we have to define this at some point. But we should also be positive. I'm sure all these nice ideas that were presented before and that are presented now are going to work together at some point because they will need each other. And this is not going to be managed or realized because the government would like us to work together. This will come from them, from their idea, or from their desire to fulfill their objectives. Thank you.
Yes.
Also, the government actually realized the necessity of the cooperation. Just for the Slovak government, we managed to establish the V4 Innovation Task Force, so putting together Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Hungary. And I think we should be using the similarities that we have in the industrial landscape. I think it's very easy for us to understand, and we have skills in automotive, in robotics. So I think maybe creating the digital innovative hub on connected cars, drones, or big data would be the next step for the regional development. So we do understand it and we do support it as well.
So now it's, I think, time to close the discussion and to say something about the voting, because there are going to be some voting on this. And perhaps you, yes, great IT support. So I'll give the floor to Annemarie, who knows a little bit more about the voting, and she can explain things here.
I cannot read the questions from here. We have designed two questions. We already designed the questions before when we set up the panel, and the first question is, what is needed in order to build up or reinforce competence centers and digital innovation hubs? And this was the discussion of the first panel, more or less. So I have listened very carefully to what the people have said, and I've put that into possible answers. And then we would like to ask you, if you go to this link, www.menti.com, and you use the code, which is over there, 996607, that you give your opinion, whether you agree or whether you don't agree with each of these questions. So the options are, what is needed is to identify the needs of the industry in the region and get them involved, develop supply chains. The second one is connect to what is already available and focus on making collaboration work. Focus existing funds on the new digitization challenge. The third option is create trust, no overregulation, focus on innovative business models. The fourth one is link to other hubs in a wider network to learn and to find what is missing in the local environment. And the fifth advice of the panelist was involve visionary people and be passionate.
Work in progress.
Yeah. We also would like to ask you if you have heard something else, if there's an option missing, whether we should add that, or whether this would be a good summary of what was said. Oh, there's a second question. You can use it if you want. Okay, this is the first question. The voting stays open until tomorrow, so you can also now continue voting, and I will maybe explain the second question. Could you move to the second question? Yes, so the second question was about the second panel. What is the role of regional governments in the support to competence centers and digital innovation hubs? Well, what we saw that all the participants did was to develop a tailor-made digitization strategy for the region. They all had a plan on what was needed. The second one is co-finance initiatives together with industry to ensure relevance, so it should not be only public funding. We also heard again, built on initiatives that are already existing and that are strong, use existing competences as far as possible, build on market studies and have a vision about new business cases. And the last one was coordinate well with digitization initiatives in other regions at national level and also the European initiatives. So also here, if you would like to see another option added, then we can still do that.
Thank you, Anne-Marie. So now it's up to me to hand over the microphone for the last time for Khalil, and he will wrap up the session.
Thanks, Maurits. Many thanks to all of you. Many thanks to our speakers. So for the session, please, a big applause to our speakers. Make it the best time. Thanks for also your questions, your voting. We should have had a debate on each of the questions, of course, to see whether we can convince you in one of the answers, but I think it would take us a bit long. Now, good discussion. As you could see, on purpose, this concept of innovation hubs, we kept some loose parts when it comes to definition, because it is a work in progress and there are a lot of good experiences that we could learn from all together. I think the way it should continue like this, and our absolutely goal is, as I said before, to share these experiences and see how we could learn from them, move ahead. The level of implementation, as you could see, in the various member states is different, and the regions is different. Some of them have already good experience. Lina gave us a very good experience of what's done in the catapults in the UK. We have also a large number of initiatives in Germany. We didn't have this today. So some others are starting with new initiatives, budgets that are being decided upon, etc. What is important, I think, is that we all engage in this process very quickly, i.e. making innovations, digital innovation, accessible to all industries across Europe. That's very important. And what is at stake, I think, it's, as many of you said, is the our capacity to maintain our competitive positioning in various industries, but also maintain a growth perspective, maintain jobs, re-bring jobs in industry in Europe. This is what is at stake, is extremely important for us. So we cannot miss this opportunity. What we talked about here was making access to technology, but I mean, it was very good on making access to innovation, but it was very good also, it came from the floor, from the speakers, the need to connect all other actors, the need to connect with investors on one side, to bring together various stakeholders across the value chain, suppliers, users, technology providers, a very good, I think it was a major consensus on that. And the connectors, bringing all this together, can be competence centers. We've seen after the catapult, you started from a competence center and you brought in all the others. Can be done through one center, but could be also through partnerships around these centers. So we've seen it working in other places. So that connection is extremely important. And I think it's something we retained. The Carinthia experience was very interesting. That also they build this connection across the various stakeholders, something that we would retain. Connecting at regional level, stakeholders, connecting at national level, but also connecting at European level. And I think there is value in building these connections across Europe. And I think the connection, to come back to Mr. Negrescu's line, We might not get a straight line, we may get a network of lines, but at least we would know where they start and where they end. That's very important. I'll stop with this. Many thanks to all of you.